Hello, welcome to the video mark scheme for the paper 2, set 3, so the third series of specimen papers that AQA have released, and the final one, so there are no new ones now. You'll be set the other ones for homework to go through, and you've started to do that already. Hopefully you've just handed some in to Andy at the front of the class, as well as some of you owe me homeworks from last Monday. And don't forget the homework for next Monday, as well as your biopsychology notes. Now what we're going to do today is we're going to go through the mark scheme, and I'd like you to check every single question, even though you've marked them, and some of you have done a really good job, others perhaps just need to develop that a bit further, be a bit stricter, or be a little less harsh with yourself. Some of you are very harsh. I'd like to go through, and the key thing I would like to see that I didn't see, which was worrying, was that people weren't putting how they could improve their scores. So people were saying they got 2 out of 5, which was very good, it's probably the accurate, but they then hadn't noted down how they could improve. Some of you have, which is brilliant, so hopefully this activity will just be checking that you haven't missed anything. But for most of you, I'd like to see you adding lots of additional extra information. So for every single question you didn't get full marks, or maybe in a few where you did, I would like you to be identifying how, if I set you this paper again, you could get 100%. Every single one of these topics could very easily come up on the real exam. So it's absolutely vital that you are that you're confident with this information as well. Okay. So grade boundaries, there they are. They're something that you'll want to return back to. And this activity should take you longer than the video. You should be pausing, you should be making notes, you should be listening back to something I've said again. This is the beauty of YouTube over other sort of me just talking to you, for two reasons. One, so you can pause, you can return to me, you can make notes and so on and so on. And secondly, if you think I've got 8 out of 8 and I'm 100%, have a quick listen to the question to make sure there was nothing you weren't just on the border of 100%, and then move on to the next one. So keep moving backwards and forwards through the video. The activity should not take you the same length of time as the video should. Okay. The activity should be much longer than the video, because the amount of times you pause, all the notes that you take, you might want to refer back to your books, to your booklets, anything like that. So question 2, you all got question, almost everybody got question 1 correct. It's a very simple ordering one, so if you didn't, have a quick look and refresh your knowledge. Question 2 was about introspection and Wundt, and a lot of you struggled with this one, I think. It's the process of observing and examining your own conscious thoughts or emotions. So in AS, I get the students, I get them to take a big bag of items. They take one item out of the bag and they have to describe to the others who note it down. They have to do it as objectively as possible. They have to explain their experiences. That doesn't mean, oh, this feels, say they had cotton wool or perfume, oh, this smells nice, or this feels squidgy. How did you feel? So an example was sandpaper. A lot of them described the fact that immediately as soon as they pulled it out, they wanted to run their fingers over it because they liked the sensation. Other people said that it set their teeth on edge, but the cotton wool did. They didn't like touching it. The way they described the feeling of experiencing it, so it was almost like it was crunchy, and that was running through, kind of echoing in their arms, even maybe their fingers. Emotionally, how did it make them feel? Did it bring back any memories? What kind of schemas did they access? Did it allow them to access various different parts of the brain? Anything like that. Okay, so remember, it's consciously what they're experiencing at this moment in time. If you're talking about the past, chances are, not always, but 90% of the time, it is the psychodynamic approach. Outline what is meant by denial and displacement, and suggest how they could be improved in Tim's situation. Andy and I were talking about this today, because in this one, the scenario itself didn't overtly demonstrate any examples of displacement or denial. You had to be more specific and add that information in yourself. You had to create that information. We think that's unlikely to come up in the real exam, so if you think that's the case, you think you've got another question like this where you need to make up the answer, you've got a bit of a definition but you need to make up the rest, you need to think very, very carefully, really check it, and then if you're 100% confident that's the case, then you need to make it up so it exactly fits the definitions of denial and displacement. 2 marks for defining each one of the defense mechanisms, and 2 marks for application. So denial is refusing to acknowledge reality. The 2 keywords there, refusing and reality. So refusing to accept or acknowledge reality. And the example here is that he refused to believe his business is gone. And then the bit I've underlined and bold, because most of you have missed it, you've not got the mark, so please make sure you add this. I was very, very generous on this one. So have a close look. Did you say just something that he refuses to believe his business is gone? That really isn't enough. You need to tell me what you would do. So he still goes to the office every day. He still gets up at 7 o'clock in the morning. He still checks his emails, whatever it is. Something that he's refusing to accept reality has actually happened, so he gets dressed every day in his work gear and goes and sits in his office, or whatever it might be. a displacement, so taking out your emotions on a substitute object, or some people said a helpless victim, which is absolutely right. So the example would be Tim takes his anger out at the bank by arguing with his family. So he's cross with the bank, but he can't do anything about that, so he argues with his family instead, kicks a bin over, whatever it might be that you want to use for that one. And then briefly evaluate disavowance mechanisms. I was so impressed that almost all of you had a really good go at this one, and some had some really good suggestions as well, so well done. If you ever get anything like this where it's an evaluate and then they give a specific component of a theory, so for example defense mechanisms is psychodynamic, or if you were asked to evaluate schemas, or if you were asked to evaluate computational models from cognitive, or the COMT gene from biological. If you're really stuck, use the evaluation points from the theory themselves, because they almost always apply. You do have to be careful and you have to think carefully about it, but they almost always apply. So if you've got a very specific component you need to evaluate, think what are the more general ones. And this is the case here. So they have practical applications. A lot of you attempted this one to say it was useful in therapy, but you didn't make it clear enough necessary to access all of the points. So for example, you said, so a lot of you talked about it being in therapy, you have to make it clear that defense mechanisms are very, very unhealthy. Even Freud acknowledged this. He said defense mechanisms were bad, that really we shouldn't use them. Maybe very temporarily to allow us to get through a situation, but if we consistently use them throughout our lives, then they are not effective. We can't deal with that unresolved internal conflict, unconscious conflict. So they're not effective. So the way you'd need to very carefully approach this is, knowledge of defense mechanisms has practical applications, because if we are aware of them when we're developing psychoanalysis, or if we're counseling somebody, then we can challenge those defense mechanisms or support them to stop using them and develop coping strategies. So they aren't, a couple of you made it sound like they were good because they can be, defense mechanisms can be used to protect you. That's not the case. You could talk about it developing effective therapies which would allow you to counteract the defense mechanisms. And then we've got another problem. The research is based on case studies. Again, you don't know this for 100%, but psychodynamic approach probably based on case studies. So the chances are that Freud developed his theory of defense mechanisms from case studies that he conducted psychoanalysis on himself. So you'll know all of the problems with case studies. We won't go into those. They're not very objective. They're small sample. They've got this, what we'd call a clinical sample. So they're all people who are experiencing some kind of mental health condition. So they can't be applied to people without mental health conditions, in the same way that you can't flip it the other way. You can't have somebody without mental health conditions apply their findings to someone with mental health conditions. Lacks testifiability or falsifiability, which loads of you mentioned, and I was so impressed with this. It's an internal process. You can't test it. You can't prove it. You can't disprove it. So therefore, it's not very scientific, not very reliable, not very valid. You have to make inferences. And then gender bias, and I've put maybe there because that is a valuation point in the psychodynamic approach. But you need to be very, very careful, because it'd be really, really tricky. You need to link it back to defense mechanisms. It would definitely be one that I would avoid. But you could possibly talk about the fact that Freud was very much gender bias. So therefore, they suggested that the defense mechanisms themselves were gender bias. Potentially, because of his understanding of women, his lack of interest in women, then the results can't be applied effectively. Men and women might use defense mechanisms differently, and that's not acknowledged. You could talk about alpha and beta bias, any of those things. On the Mark scheme, the suggestions were lack of testability or falsifiability. They can only be inferred from behavior. So in the same way we talk about the cognitive approach and inferences, it's exactly the same thing. Examples. So I couldn't find any specific examples, but you might know if someone might want to do some quick research on a few. But for example, victims of abuse very much experience denial. They refuse to acknowledge the situation. People experiencing grief, lots of different things. So there is real world evidence or examples that support that, suggesting that it's valid. Although if they're case studies, that of course brings up its whole other issues. And then you've got, I found a piece of research here that you might like to use, but I wouldn't worry excessively about defense mechanisms. Boymeister, who found evidence of denial and other defense mechanisms using, and I put around there, normal population, so a population, a non-clinical population, a population without mental health conditions, so what, not an extreme clinical sample. So of course Freud worked with some people with some very complex mental health conditions, so that was a strength of the research. It did find evidence, and it used a more generalizable population, but limited evidence for displacement but some evidence of emotional states being carried over. So you couldn't really find any evidence of displacement. They did find that sometimes you take your emotional state, you transfer it to another situation as well. So it's not possibly that you're displacing that anger from the bank to your family, but you're still cross when you talk to the when you've spoken to the bank. So you take that anger home with you. What is meant by cognitive neuroscience and describe one practical application? I saw a lot of people making this mistake. They did gave themselves a mark, but actually they made cognitive neuroscience sound like the biological approach when they are very, very different and you would not be allocated a mark. The other thing you want to have a look at, the AO1 here is 4, so you need to tell me all about cognitive neuroscience for 4 marks, and only 2 are application. So a lot of people again gave themselves too many marks. If you only talked about practical applications and a really brief reference to cognitive neuroscience, maximum you're going to get is 3 marks. So just look at that carefully. That might be the reason I changed your mark. The biological, the structure of the brain influences behaviour. Structure of the brain, we know this, biological structures such as the brain, digestive system, endocrine system, whatever, influence our behaviour. That's not cognitive neuroscience. Cognitive neuroscience is exactly as it said there, the scientific study of the brain or neurological, so brain structures, that are responsible for internal mental processes. So cognitive, internal mental processes, neuro, brain, and then science, the scientific study, and then that moves us nicely onto brain scans. Make sure in your definition you've talked about internal mental processes because of the cognitive approach. Neuro, we're looking at how the structure of the brain affects internal mental processes and the way that we process, understand and think about information. And then science, we study it in a scientific manner. For example, brain scans. Using brain scans when previously we had to use autopsies, scans allowed them to observe active internal mental processes. So previously we had to wait for someone to die. Somebody who's dead very rarely shows internal mental thought processes. They very rarely have a thinking pattern. So having the scans allowed us to look at active internal mental processes. And then we studied various different areas such as memory. And there you could have mentioned Gage and Barocca. And then make it really, really clear that you've moved on to the application. So use the phrase, one practical application is dot, 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 and then say what it is. That's really useful because, as I said on the previous slide, you could talk about Gage and Barocca. You don't want to think the examiner thinks that's your practical application. You want to really go into detail in the practical application, so you want to make that cutoff clear. Okay, and then you have more for AO1, because admittedly it is limited AO1. So practical applications, things we looked at. Murderers, we looked at Horizon, so look back on your notes on that. We looked at super brands, so we fMRI scans, and somebody looked at an Apple and a non-Apple product, and the part of the brain that's linked to religion. Notice that. And then Gage with personality, impulse control, localization, and Barocca with language center. So if you chose not to use those for AO1, you can use them for AO2 as well. Other things suggested on the mark scheme, they looked at different types of memory, and you've talked to that with Andy. We've looked at the mental processes of depression, people with depression or OCD, autism or dyslexia, normal aging, the effects of strokes. You could use computational models, I wouldn't worry so much about that one. Voice recognition, so you can use, we can develop through internal mental processes and thought processes, we can use voice recognition programs and use of eye tracking as well. Then we're going to look at outline Pavlov's research and describe how classical conditioning might explain a child's fear. This is the other way round. So AO1 is 3. You only get 3 marks for talking about Pavlov, and a lot of you talked about him in a lot more detail. And then you get 5 marks for AO2 for a child's fear of school. So you must go into a bit more detail. I was generous with this one and kind of balanced it out, but really the application is where all the marks are. So if you outlined Pavlov's research generally accurately, so that allows you to have some slight mistakes, but not many. If your application was thorough and effective, and this is what dragged a few people down, and the other key thing was specialist terminology, you must use it effectively. Okay. And there I've put it on again because it's so important. Use terminology. Now the key thing I would do is I would say that you need to have an introductory sentence that talks about classical conditioning and learning by association. Don't go straight into Pavlov. Pavlov was the guy who developed the concept of classical conditioning, so you can talk about the fact it's learning through association before you go directly into his research. It is better to show you more general knowledge before you talk about research, particularly as this is an AS thing, AS, so they want to see more than you just have learnt off by heart which one is which some of you still need to do. So you've got unconditioned stimulus, a stimulus which has a natural or unlearnt response, unconditioned response, which is a natural response to an unconditioned stimulus, such as salivation, neutral stimulus has no natural response. Naturally, you have no response to this. Please, can you all check your understanding of neutral stimulus? Because a lot of you got your neutral stimuluses wrong. And then conditioned stimulus is associated with the unconditioned stimulus to give a learnt response. So the tuning fork was associated with the food, and then they developed a learnt response. A conditioned response is a learnt response, such as salivation. So remember, conditioned or unconditioned means, so unconditioned means unlearned and natural, and conditioned means learned, which should help you out. And then here, the thing that dragged a lot of you down with the schooling was you explained it brilliantly, you didn't necessarily use the right terminology. So if you can pause and have a look at that, if you've noted that down so far, I think I only noticed one person who noted this specific specialist kind of way of explaining it. So do have a look at those particular words. So fear arousing event and school are paired together, associated. You can use the word contagious, but that's more of an exam board word, but you are welcome to do it. And then eventually school becomes a conditioned stimulus, which will now elicit fear. So when the original fear arousing event is not present, so even when the bullying isn't there, they're still scared of school. So just think about the wording of that, okay? This one, identify two components of the peripheral nervous system. Some of you struggle with that, which is worrying itself, and then explain two differences. So you get a mark for saying autonomic and a mark for talking about somatic. And then if you have a look at the bold and underlined at the bottom here, there must be explicit focus on differences between the somatic and the autonomic nervous system for marks to be awarded. So you can't say the somatic nervous system is this, the autonomic nervous system is this. You must link them together, and literally all that takes is this the word whereas. So don't have sentence one, sentence two, have sentence one that doesn't finish with a full stop, whereas, and then carry on to sentence two, just like we have here. So the somatic nervous system is sensory and motor, whereas the autonomic is purely motor. The autonomic controls internal organs, whereas the somatic controls skeletal muscles and movement, and the autonomic controls centers in the brainstem, whereas the somatic carries commands from the motor cortex. Just have a look at those, make some notes on that, and do ask me if there's anything you're not sure of. Using your knowledge of plasticity and functional recovery, explain Josie's recovery. Terminology. Top band answers may to refer to one of the above points in detail, and you'll see those points in a minute. You can talk about relevant studies, but it's not vital. And then this is my point at the bottom. It's excellent. I was so pleased that you were saying, well, it must be that it's vernix area and Broca's area because you can't do this, this and this. Unfortunately, that doesn't get you any marks. Read carefully. Plasticity and functional recovery doesn't mention localization at any point. So please think really carefully. You're doing really, really well, but just be careful not to give information that isn't relevant. So due to Josie being young, she's more likely to experience recovery. Neural reorganisation, or we could talk about neural unmasking, could have happened, which is when part of Josie's brain is undamaged, takes over the language function. So you've got those neurons that don't ever really work when you're younger. You don't really need them because kind of that part of the brain doesn't get stimulated enough. One part of the brain gets damaged, so then all of a sudden that information is being flooded to you. So it's almost kind of like a floodgate, like a overflow system. So once the sink's blocked, once that part of the area is not working anymore because of damage, but we'll think about blocking, then the activity flows into that part of that brain, waking up all the other neurons that haven't been working for ages, and they take over that. And there's also neuroregeneration, where the brain grows new connections or neurons. So that would be about functional recovery. So either new neurons start, old neurons that were there take over the function, or new neurons are grown. And then plasticity allows the brain to cope with the indirect effects of brain damage. So it makes it easier, all the other things that happen that are a problem. Two glands and their functions. Then you've got the pituitary and the adrenal gland, which are the two key ones, and you've got their functions there. Again, effective use of terminology. If you see, that's a bottom bullet point. Knowledge of the two glands and the endocrine system is clear and mostly accurate. The answer is generally coherent with effective use of terminology. Discuss what research has shown about localization of functioning. I don't think many people did this. Well done for not mixing up localization and lateralization. Please be careful. Localization, different areas of the brain have different roles. Lateralization, the two hemispheres. Well done for reading the question so carefully, because it does talk about research. However, just bear in mind that if it says research, it does mean research or theory, so you literally can talk about anything you know to do with localization there. It doesn't just have to be Broca Engage or Wernicke or whatever it might be. You can talk about theories, you can define the concept, everything, whatever you can do. And AO1 was 3 and AO3 was 5. So a little bit of description and lots of evaluation. Discuss is both describe and evaluate. It's worrying that some of you are still not discussing. You're still not describing and evaluating when you see a discuss. Please do not do that in the exam. You will lose lots and lots of marks. You'd lose 5 there, which is over 50% of this question, which is already a tricky one. You don't want to make your life more difficult. Things you could have talked about, visual. So first of all, I would say you want to define it. You want to say localization is when one area of the brain controls particular functions. And then you've got the visual, the somatosensory cortex, the auditory centres, and the Broca and Wernicke's area. Loads of notes on those. I'm going to skim through them quickly, pause any points that you need to. I'm not going to talk over those. And then we had Peterson. So make it really, really clear that they did did a brain scan, and they looked at people when they were reading out loud and when there was a listening task. So reading out loud is speech production. So think carefully about which part of the brain that is. And then, of course, a listening task, which is understanding the information. And they found that when reading out loud, Broca's part of the brain was activated, whereas when it was a listening task, Wernicke's area, so understanding, was activated. So that supports the idea that one part of the brain does one thing and one part of the brain does another. And then we've got ipecacuanticipotentiality, which is something that we'll look at on the other slides, and Drucker with Tan doing a scan again, Doherty and Lashley, which was mentioned on the mark scheme. So these are bits of information you need to know about the visual centres. Have a read of that. The somatosensory, the auditory, and of course localization. And loads of you are really good with localization for Tan, which is excellent. Then we had brain scans, supporting evidence, so listening, exactly as I said, and why that's a strength. So have a look at that. And then neurosurgical evidence. So you've got Doherty, who legioned part of the brain and found that 1/3 of patients with OCD benefited from that, which suggests that if you're damaging part of the brain and then a behaviour is being removed, then that each part of the brain is responsible for certain things. So in this case, there was certain mental health, OCD was being controlled by a certain part of the brain, supporting the idea that certain bits of the brain do certain functions. So again, have a read closely of that one, so pause it. And then the equipotentiality theory, which was in the dog book, not the cat book, and is Lashley's research with rats. So you've got localization theory is competing with this other theory, which suggests that basic functions are localized, but more complex functions are holistic. So there are basic things which bits of the brain do, and then really complex functions, they take the whole of the brain, or bits of several different bits of the brain are involved in that. And that Lashley found there was no one particular part of the rat's brain that was important in running a maze. So presumably, I'm not sure, but maybe you chop chunks out to find it and see whether it made a difference. And generally didn't find any particular part when you remove that, when you lesion that they couldn't learn to run a maze anymore. And then this is a weakness that suggests that a variety of parts of the brain are needed to complete higher order thinking. So learning is an incredibly complex and higher level thought process, and that is something that requires all of the brain. So it goes against localization theory. And then finally, language production isn't confined to Broca's area. So we've got Drucker, who did an MRI scan and found that other parts of the brain might have experienced damage as well. So it's exactly the same thing of cause and effect. Is it that damage to Broca's brain caused the problem? Damage to Tan's brain was what caused the speech production problems, or is it that the fact that by damaging that part of the brain, other bits of the brain were damaged as well, and all of that together led to problems? And that links back to the previous kind of holistic theory that we look at too. Right, brief explanation of synaptic transmission. I'm not going to go through this in lots of detail. Hopefully what we did on Monday cleared that up. You've got the electrical impulse runs down the axon, the presynaptic neuron, and triggers the release of neurotransmitters across the synaptic gap. For full marks, there must be some reference to drugs affecting synaptic transmission. Neurotransmitters are chemical. Electrical impulses are the bits in between the neurotransmitter. They bind to the receptor sites. You could talk about excitatory and inhibitory, and then you could talk about SSRIs that block reuptake, making more serotonin available in the synaptic gap, and link that back to Raoul and help him understand what's happening. So if reuptake can't happen, then there's more serotonin or whatever it may be in the synaptic gap. This one, horrible question, mean one from the exam board, but one that you just bear in mind, the hypothesis should be directional because previous research has indicated a direction. So previously the research has suggested this, so we would have a directional hypothesis. If we didn't know, then we would have a non-directional hypothesis. What is meant by operationalization? The way you get the four marks here is it's clearly specifying or defining something to make it measurable. So you must say it's clearly specifying or giving a definition, and then you must mention about the measurableness as well. And then make sure the examples you give are operationalized. I had a couple of people give examples and they weren't operationalized, so that didn't get you any marks. Use of cycle lanes, passing pedestrians of a distance of 1 meter, using the bicycle bell. If you mention speeds, make sure you mention what. So if you're saying sensible speed, mention what kind of speed, anything like that, okay? Face validity is where a behaviour appears at first sight to represent what is being measured. Having a dog, and then link it. So having a dog on the lead appears at first glance to measure considerate behaviour, and then explain why. Because if a dog is on a lead, it's less able to upset people, bite somebody, chase somebody. So that's a considerate behaviour. So define the term, link it back to the stimulus, explain why. Briefly outline two types of validity. You've got concurrent validity, and now some of you I didn't credit for this, and the reason that I didn't credit you you just want to be really careful, it probably shouldn't be on the list, apologies. It's a way of assessing validity. I think I'd probably accept it, so if I marked you down, give it a tick and let me know and I'll take it away, but just be ever so careful. Generally, concurrent validity is a way of assessing validity, so it's whether there's an agreement with a pre-existing measure that is also validated. So if an IQ test, which we're confident is measuring IQ, agrees with the new IQ test, then you can be confident that they're concurring, that they agree. Internal validity, are we confident of cause and effect? So we're confident the only thing affecting the IV is the DV and nothing else. External validity, can it be generalised to other situations outside of the research environment they originally gathered in? Be ever so careful of that, because a lot of people are defining as external and ecological validity in the same way. Can it be generalised to other situations outside of the research environment? So that doesn't mean automatically mean in the natural world, it just means can they be generalised to other situations that aren't exactly like the research, the where we've gathered the research. Temporal validity, can the research be the findings be applied beyond the time period? Population validity, can the results be generalised to the target population? We don't want to apply it to the general population, we want to apply it specifically to the target population. And then ecological validity, where a measure of behaviour accurately reflects the way in which the behaviour would occur in normal, natural circumstances. Been a bit flexible with some of those on that, but that's very good. Event sampling and time sampling, now you either got that question wrong or right, however. Event is every time you see one of your behavioural categories happen, you tally it. So you watched the child on Super Nanny kicking things over and you'd created some behavioural characteristics and you tallied them every time you saw them. And then time is noting everything that happened down a certain time frame. So we watched the clip of the girl, I think it was a girl in the idea institutionalisation and the effect that attachment and deprivation had. She was in the hospital, she was very upset because her mother had left. Every 20 seconds, at the start of that second 20 seconds, we recorded what was happening. Obviously, I couldn't quite get you to do it like this, but it's more common that it be on the first 5 minutes of every hour. So at 9 o'clock till 5 past 9, at 10 o'clock till 10 past till 5 past 10, 11 o'clock till 5 past 11, and so on. You would note down everything that you saw. That's the difference between the two. Explain how inter-observer reliability could be ensured. As soon as you see explain how, that means how do you do it. Don't tell me anything else about it. Don't define it. Just tell me exactly. Somebody's saying, give me instructions. How do I do this? This is how you do it. You identify behavioural categories beforehand. I don't think hardly anybody mentioned that. So you identify your behavioural categories beforehand. You agree them beforehand. You observe the same target independently. So you go away and conduct the observations separately on exactly the same thing. And then you correlate your results for similarity. Step, step, step. Explain how. Make it really clear. A lot of you had loads of waffly rubbish that you didn't need in there. Step one, step two, step three. This is what they do. This is what they do. This is what they do. Explain how. Show your workings and present your answers in the simplest form. Almost everybody did this brilliantly. Well done. The only thing that a lot of people didn't do was they didn't explain it in its simplest form. So take it all the way down to three over two. Explain why chi squared was appropriate. Hopefully now you all understand that a bit more. It's always, you mention whether it's a difference or a correlation. A lot of you said it's not correlational. I would encourage you to use the phrase it's looking for a difference, but I think I credited either because I was feeling generous. Experimental design and levels of data. So it was a difference, it was nominal, and it was independent groups. You don't need to know anything. You could say any word on there. Chi squared, unrelated t-test, related t-test, sign test. Those three things, design, data, and difference, are the things that you need to tell me. So that's a lovely question. It's not quite a nice, easy one. and then you all calculated this very effectively. I don't think a single person got it wrong. Well done. And then state whether or not the results of the chi-squared test is significant at the 0.05 level of significance. Justify your answer. Yes, it was significant. The calculated value, open brackets, you must include the numbers of chi-squared, is more than the critical table value, open brackets, include the data. At a 0.05 level of significance, when the degrees of freedom is 2, when using a one-tailed test, it is directional, you use a one-tailed test, non-directional, two-tailed, you must mention the one-tailed test to get you 3 marks. Write a short paragraph the students could use to do this. It was discuss, it wasn't explain. If it was explaining, it would be in the results. You've got to discuss and consider the reliability, the how confident you can be. So you take it that step further. You're not going to be asked the same question twice. A lot of people repeated the information. That's not what they're looking for. They're looking for you to discuss, to consider how reliable, how valid, how confident they can be about their results. So level of significance is an indication that the likelihood the results are due to chance and not due to cause and effect. So what are the likelihood the results are due to chance? You've all explained this to me. They can be 95% confident the result, a significant result, is due to cause and effect. So 5% chance that there's results are due to, appear to be due to, significant, but are actually due to chance. In this case, the calculated value exceeds the critical value of 0.05, but doesn't meet the more stringent significant level of 0.01. So we so somewhere in between, we know we could have made a type 1 error somewhere in between 0.05 and 0.01. So there's a possibility of a type 1 error if we accept the alternative hypothesis. Explain how students, so explain how step by step would they do it, the students develop their interview findings, and why content analysis would be appropriate. Why is it appropriate? 1 mark, they're analysing qualitative data. Done. How do you carry out content analysis? You identify what you are going to analyse. They've already done this, but you pick what you are going to consider, what you're going to analyse. You familiarise yourself with the sample and identify categories, and then you go through the sample, you tally everything, and then you conduct statistical analysis. Fed up of talking about content analysis, please, please, please find out what it is. Learn that process, that step-by-step process, so sample, familiarise, analyse, and then statistical analysis, so that you can get the marks, because I think content analysis always one students struggle with, so very likely to come up. Suggest one inconsiderate behaviour students might focus on in their content analysis. There's loads of examples. I think everybody, almost everybody, got it right. A couple of you possibly swayed a little bit because you didn't read it carefully. Need to talk about in sixth form. You're not talking about bikes or anything else anymore. You're talking about in sixth form centre. So just be careful. Leaving rubbish, leaving dirty mugs and plates, playing music loudly, throwing books and shouting, which of course are none of the things that you as students do. And then planning an experiment. You have to ask yourself the question, have you considered all, and in this case it was 3 elements, but if not, have you considered all of the bullet points? So you need to tick, and my advice would be to tick them off as you go, which I didn't see people doing. Otherwise you are limited to half marks, which is bad. This is such an easy one to pick marks upon when you're used to it. There's nothing complicated about it. It's just combining everything you know into one thing. So it's got to be practical and well detailed. So can you actually conduct it? Don't suggest you do something ridiculous. Justifications were sound, enough detail for the study to be implemented and replicated. Read it through, think, if I gave this to someone else, could I replicate it? The answer for quite a few of yours wasn't always yes. And as always, specialist terminology. The easiest way to approach it, I would say, is go through and think, these are all the things I need to include, tick them off one by one. I would do this, so I think it mentions experimental design first. The experimental design I would use is this. The reason, and then justify, the reason I would use this experimental design is because the IV and the DV are, because that's what they mentioned next, and then I can't remember what the next one is, and so on. So obviously you can't justify IV and DV, but go through, tick off the list, the 2 things they want you to do in this one. So just be careful, read the other ones closely, because they don't always ask this, but I would use this because this is, and that's it, really, ever so simple. So the key thing was, did your measure of mood use ordinal level data? A lot of them didn't. You didn't even mention it, some of you. So hopefully now we've gone through ordinal level data, you'd have been more successful. It's placing things into a rank or placing them on a scale. Have you named the variables, the IV and DV? Are they operationalised? Have you suggested a control? Descriptive data, measure of central tendency, measure of dispersion. Have you referred to a statistical test? If you could tick every single one of those off, you are very, very close to having completed it. I think the only one I missed out is the experimental design. So it's just a simple list ticking activity, okay? And that appears to be it. So Go through, mark your exam paper. Either I'll have given you a mark, if you can give yourselves a mark. Go back to the grade boundaries. So if we fly back through quickly, oh, this is going to take ages. Back to the grade boundaries, you can work out roughly what grade boundaries you've got. These grade boundaries are a bit unreliable, because they are from AS, so who knows for A2, you're the first ones to do it, which has its benefits, but it also has its drawbacks as well. But these are roughly the idea. Please don't be too disheartened if you didn't quite get what you want. Think carefully, pick out consistently what were you not doing that you should have. You'd lose some, that is the thing that you need to focus on, okay? Once you've completed that, you can start working through your homework that's due in for Monday, or you can start doing some independent revision. Please let me know if there's anything you're not sure of, okay? Thank you.